You gotta let the grill do its job. You know, too many people are peekers and pokers, and they want to touch it right away, and they're like so impatient. Just slowing down, let the grill do the work. Once it's gonna release, it's gonna tell you almost. You know, and again, if you have sight and smell, a lot of things are gonna be self-evident to you. So many things that you can add to your cooking that are gonna give you a different flavor profile. When you're in the experimenting phase and you're trying to play around, I see no issues with stuff like that. But at some point, just like in a marriage, you know what works.
I'm Mary Mammoliti.
And I'm Jenny Arena.
And we're Bits and Bites.
Welcome back to part two of All Up in My Grill. If you missed part one, pause this episode and go back and listen to episode 39 of the Bits and Bites podcast. We're always thinking of you when it comes to dishing on hot topics, and sometimes 15 minutes just isn't enough. Today, we're dishing out a second helping of All Up in My Grill.
Last episode, we talked about charcoal versus gas and a brilliant MacGyver hack for turning your charcoal grill into a smoker.
Natural gas and propane, it's the ease of lighting it. Natural gas, propane, one beer before you can start grilling. Charcoal, between 3 to 4 beers before you start cooking.
In this episode, we bring you the flavor bomb and talk rubs, sauces, marbleization, so much more. So, let's hear it from grillmaster Rob Rainford. So let's talk about some of the foods that we can and cannot grill. Are there really any that you can't grill?
Yeah, there's nothing you cannot put on a barbecue. I think that there are things that are a little bit more difficult. So if you don't have a hot enough grill and your grates are not clean, trying to cook fish on a medium temperature, it's going to stick on you and you're going to have a problem with that. Even if you oil down your grates and you know, make sure that you have that pristine environment, if the fire is not hot enough, you're going to have some issues with that. But outside of fish, there are some foods that are much more applicable to enjoyment than are, you know, disaster. So if you're going to use the perfect grilling steak is a ribeye, because it's got two cuts of meat plus a layer of fat in there, and fat adds flavor. So it's super imperative that you find something that's not overly lean when you're outside grilling. Because again, if you want juiciness, you got to get that hard sear. So I like to say about 2.5 minutes, turn 2.5 minutes, 2.5 minutes. Then you got yourself pretty much rare at that point. And then shunt it over to a cooler side and just let it cook up gently. Okay. And this is for the lay person out there that's not a grilling aficionado. But again, if you are a person like me that's, you know, worked in steakhouses and you've had to grill, you know, 1,200 steaks a night, yeah, you don't have that luxury. You mark and you cook and you feel and you try to get it out there and you pray your customer doesn't realize you made a mistake. So again, ribeye is a great steak for grilling. You know, chicken thighs, chicken legs, those are even better than chicken breasts to cook, because again, with the chicken breast, if you overcook it, it's dry. With a leg and a thigh, even if you screw up, it's still kind of tender. Knowing when to do things is probably more important than how you do it. And again, vegetables are great on the grill. Great, you know, people are not inspired by saying, I'm going to make the best barbecue zucchini you've ever had. Like, what?
Yeah.
Could you go play by yourself, you know? So, but again, any vegetable, peppers, you know, you can blister them on and then take that skin off. If you use a green pepper as opposed to a red pepper, that's going to make a huge difference, because a green pepper is a young pepper and a red pepper is a more mature pepper. So the skin's not going to come off of your green pepper as fast as it would come off of your red or yellow or the other colors. Mm-hmm. So just note what do you want? What is the end result that you're looking for? And here's one thing I have to say to people. When you put your food on a grill, you got to let the grill do its job. You know, too many people are peekers and pokers and they want to touch it right away. And they're like, they're so impatient. Just slowing down, let the grill do the work. Once it's going to release, it's going to tell you almost, you know. And again, if you have sight and smell, a lot of things are going to be self-evident. My issue also, you know, when you put your hand over the fire, if you can't hold it there for 5 seconds, your grill is like way too hot. If you can't do it, just relax a little bit. Let it cool down a touch or move things around. And again, with gas grilling, none of these things are self-evident because you can always have the zones ready to go and make sure that you, and most people will buy a pretty decent barbecue.
I want to get into flare-ups. How do we deal with flare-ups?
Flare-ups are easy. That's, I told you, water bottle beside you. You squirt them like your cat trying to scratch your furniture. Couple squirts in the face, you're out of here. But it just water. That's it. Again, if you're having a grease fire because you haven't cleaned your barbecue in a while, remember, and those are the flare-ups that you really have to be cognizant of. And that you now have to close the lid, starve it of oxygen, and then remove things afterwards when they calm down. Everybody's had a grilling mishap. And I remember at the beginning, I got a couple, I used to have like a graveyard of grills in my backyard until my wife said, that's not going to happen. I had a grill, which I hadn't cleaned the catch basin out on in probably a month. And I was upstairs on my second floor. And I'm looking, I'm like, wow, that's a lot of smoke. I look down, there's a couple of flames shooting out of my grill. So I had a propane grill at that time, so I had to come down, shut everything down. And that was one of our disastrous nights of, ordering pizza. But we made it through. But cleaning your grill is super important and having the water bottle beside you.
Let's talk sauces and rubs. Are the two pretty much interchangeable, or is there an instance where you would pick one over the other?
I think they're very interchangeable. I think that a dry rub and a rub is what it says it is, that when you put it on your meat, you got to rub it in, okay? So you can't blow on it. It's not going to make the same impression. So rubs give you that beautiful surface, and it'll give you the bark that you're looking for, as opposed to just sprinkling things on. There's always got to be a binder. So here's a great example of if you're going to do baby back ribs, I use a little bit of mustard, French's mustard, and that's acting as my binder. Mm-hmm. If you don't like the mustard approach, then just use a little bit of oil and then just pat that into the both sides of your grill. Obviously, make sure the membrane's off. And then cook those guys direct heat for a third of the time and then shunt them to the cooler side for the rest of the cooking time. Ribs take you anywhere between 3.5 hours up as high as 5 hours. So it's not one of those meals that you're going to say, let me just come home from work at 5 o'clock because nobody wants to eat at 12 in the morning, you know? And again, not putting on, with your pro, like people like to put barbecue sauce on way too early. Barbecue sauce can only go on in the last 4 or 5 minutes of the cooking process because of the sugar content. It's going to burn. Again, and it's a lot, and it's just a quick basting, you know what I mean? So you just want to get that little stickiness there. That's it. You're not looking for it smothered. And you know, it's almost like when we used to go out for wings. Some people liked it dripping down their elbow, the Salt Bay reverse thing. You know, I want it stuck to the skin and to the surface.
Do you have a go-to dry rub recipe that you could share with us?
I love my jerk stuff. So if you Google Rob Rainford jerk, you'll get a great recipe. It'll pop right up. My jerk marinade is wonderful. I have a multitude of different spice blends, and I like to tell people you can go out and buy Montreal steak spice. It's simple. It's easy. It's already pre-done for you. But what if there's something in there that you don't like? So I would suggest you go out and buy yourself a smoked paprika, a regular paprika, cayenne and chili and onion powder, garlic powder, and then start doing the blend yourself. Because I think we all have a nuanced palate that we when you go out to like, say, a Montana's and you eat their ribs, you go, I like it, but I don't like it. There's something there that I don't. They're using like that heavy sort of that barbecue sauce that has that mesquite flavor in it, or it's not even mesquite. It's actually the liquid smoke. And liquid smoke is unlike any other, it's a synthetic smoke. It's almost like if you're going to buy good weed, buy good weed. Don't buy anything. Don't buy that other stuff.
Right. None of that imitation stuff.
But yeah, it's kind of imperative that you make your blend, do your blends on your own. I'm a staunch supporter of that. And with my charcoal cooking that I've been doing, I literally for a year and a half now, I have not cooked on gas at all. It's only charcoal at home. And what I like now is just salt and pepper. That's it. butcher, black pepper, and cracked sea salt. That's it. That's my flavor base now. I don't want the onion powder, the garlic powder. I don't want any of those flavors anymore. I just want to taste meat. The Texas barbecue is kind of like the king of barbecues out there, because they simplified it in a way that they're just using all the natural elements. And, you know, if you go to Carolina, if you go to Tennessee, if you Kansas City barbecue, yeah, they all use like more vinegars or more mustard base. And again, regional North Carolina, I don't mind regional barbecue, but we're Canadians. So what we're better at than anything on the planet is the fact that we can just adopt things for ourselves. We're not Carolina. We are Toronto. Like I like the fact that I use what I want to use. And I'm not trying to say that this is authentic to you. This is what I like. Plain and simple.
Have you tried spruce tip?
Yes, I have. And I don't, you know what? I don't mind. Again, there are so many things that you can add to your cooking that is going to give you a different flavor profile. And again, when you're in the experimenting phase and you're trying to play around, I see no issues with stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But at some point, just like in a marriage, you know what works.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You don't need to do a somersault before you come into the bed. Just, you know.
So I do want to ask a question, because I'm low vision and I love to grill. And I'm always, always, always looking for some other tips, safety tips when it comes to grilling. Do you have any that you could share?
Safety tips: buying a good set of oven proof or barbecue proof gloves that go up to your elbow. Wonderful. Because if you need to remove a grate or whatever, at least you feel safe, as opposed to trying to use a kitchen towel and tongs. And, you know, I've used every different incarnation of things that are dangerous. I have done them. I am the poster child for danger. So buying the gloves is great. And again, making sure that you have a place to step back. And again, gas grilling, don't have your grill on high the whole time, because I think a lot of people make that mistake that, just crank it on high and I'll do what I need to do. You're not going to do what you need to do, because once fire hits, I've seen seasoned cooks start dancing when I go, you're not supposed to be dancing here. Like I have move them off to the side. And especially, when you're on the grill and you're trying to move things around and your knuckles are burning.
Yes.
And you know, you want to get it off. Just if you had on a set of gloves, boom, they're off. Done.
Yeah.
You saved yourself.
Jenny, what did you learn today?
Mary, I've learned that all this talk about barbecue is making me hungry and I'm ready to fire up my grill. What's your takeaway?
So my takeaway from this episode is that Rob said it's okay to call him a jerk. Okay, but only when you're doing a Google search for his jerk recipe. Sorry, Rob. Thank you for listening, and don't forget to subscribe to Bits and Bytes on your favorite podcast player and leave us a review and star rating.
We'd like to thank our editor, Matt Agnew, and remind all of you to take a little time to chew, chat, and chuckle.
I forgot to ask the question.
Oh, why were you supposed to ask?
That's our little shtick.
Oh, sorry. All right, take two on the extra.